to the world, the Lord is come. Let earth receive her King. Let every heart prepare him room. And heaven and nature sing, and heaven and nature sing, and heaven and nature sing. Joy to the earth, the Savior reigns. Let men their songs implore, while fields and floods, rocks, hills, and plains repeat the sounding joy, repeat the sounding joy, repeat, repeat the sounding joy. No more let sins and sorrows reign, nor thorns infest the ground. He comes to make his blessings flow, far as the curse is found, far as the curse is found, far as
be seated, everyone. Where's my friend Ramon? Anybody notice anything different? Yes, there's we have a new carpet.
Good morning, church. How are you doing? My name is Ramon Cabrera. We want to pray for Calvary Bible Church of Derry, New Hampshire. And I welcome everybody else. That's it, Pastor. Say what? And for the ushers. That's all I know, Pastor. I'm bad. Oh, for our service, I'm sorry.
Yep, we're going to pray for
Calvary Bible Church in Derry, New Hampshire. Amen. Thank you, Pastor.
Well, I mean, you can pray.
Oh, I could do that too. Okay. In the name of Jesus, hallelujah. Jesus, hallelujah. We take this moment, hallelujah, to pray for our brothers and sisters in Calvary Church of Derry, New Hampshire, that the Lord be able to bless them and glorify them with Jesus, hallelujah. We praise you, we love you. So our church also, Jesus, hallelujah. Thank you, Lord, amen. Newcomers. No? I'm bad, Pastor. Greedy? Okay. We do this now? Yeah. Greeting you, brothers and sisters of. No?
Stand up and greet
everybody. Greet everybody.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Praise the Lord.
Who breaks the power of sin and darkness, whose love is mighty and so much stronger, the King of glory, the King above all kings. Who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder and leaves us breathless in awe and wonder, the King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. Lord, you laid down your life. That I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Back into order, who makes the orphan a son and daughter, the King of glory, the King above all kings. Oh, tell me, who rules the nations with truth and justice, shines like the sun in all of its brilliance, the King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. Oh Lord, you laid down your life. That I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave.
Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy, worthy, worthy. Oh, this is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. Lord, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross. Oh, you laid down your life, that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Oh, yes, this is amazing grace. This is unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross. Oh, you laid down your life, that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Over the mountains and the sea, your river runs with love for me. And I will open up my heart, let the healer set me free. I'm happy to be in the truth, and I will daily lift my hands. I will always sing when your love came down.
Sing it over the mountains.
Over the mountains and the sea, your river runs with love for me. And I will open up my heart and let the healer set me free. I'm happy to be in the truth, and I will daily lift my hands. I will always sing of when your love came down. I could sing of your love forever. 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 Over the mountains and the sea, your river runs with love for me. And I will open up my heart and let the healer set me free. I'm happy to be in the truth, and I will daily lift my hands. I will always sing of when your love came down. I could sing of your love forever. I could sing of your love forever. I could sing of your love forever. I could sing of your love forever.
I could sing.
I could sing of your love forever. I could sing of your love forever. I could sing of your love forever. I could sing of your love forever.
Oh, sing of your love.
Hark the herald angels sing, glory to the newborn King, peace on earth and mercy. Pleased as man with men to dwell,
the serpent's head. Adam's likeness now we face, stamp thine image in its place. Second Adam from above, reinstate us in thy love. Hark, the herald angels sing, glory to the newborn King. Hail to you, Jesus, lift up your name, Jesus, Jesus, Lord to me, Master, Savior, Prince of Peace, ruler of my heart today, Jesus, Lord, to me. Oh,
today, take your throne upon our praise. Gathered at the highest throne, welcomed by a song that's always been in me. All glory and honor, dominion and power to you. A million angels fall face down on the floor,
help us sing with all of heaven roar. Forever echo, holy is the Lord. Holy, holy. Forever echo, holy is the Lord.
Holy,
holy. Forever echo, holy is the Lord.
Mesmerized by every heart, been written in eternity.
Every lifted voice above,
join your voice,
joining in the symphony. All glory and honor, dominion and power to you. A million angels fall face down on the floor, all to echo, holy is the Lord. My heart can't help but sing with all of heaven roar. Forever echo, holy is the Lord. Holy, holy, forever echo.
There before the throne of grace,
majesty before my eyes.
Oh God,
let it take my breath away. All glory and honor, dominion and power to you. A million angels fall face down on the floor, all to echo, holy is the Lord. My heart can't help but sing with all of heaven roar. Forever echo, holy is the Lord. A million angels fall face down on the floor, all to echo, holy is the Lord. My heart can't help but sing with all of heaven roar. Forever echo, holy is the Lord. Holy, holy, forever echo.
Be seated, everyone. You know, I keep wanting to remind you, and I keep forgetting, but any time during the service, including our worship time, I know we do our altar time at the end of service, but if any time you want to come to the altar and just pray, even during worship, you just want to worship down here, you are welcome to be at the altar
as just a taste of that time when all of eternity stands before us. And we come before the throne and echo the call of the angels, "Holy is the Lord." Amen. Hey, I want to welcome you, everybody, to Riverside today. My name is Pastor Dan, if you don't know me, and we're glad to have you with us today. I want to especially send out a welcome to anybody who may be here with us for the first time. You're visiting with us, and we're glad that you're here. Hope that you're enjoying the presence of these good people and the presence of the Lord together. And we have a gift for you. We want to put something there in your hands to remind you a little bit about who we are. Welcome. Raise your hand if you've got anybody else. Yes. We're glad to have you with us. Anybody else, make sure you keep your hand up until we put one of those packets of information there in your hand. In that packet of information, you'll see what looks like a little postcard with our church logo on it. If you would be willing to just put your name and address on there so that we can send you a letter or an email or a text or a phone call just to say welcome, we're glad that you're here with us, please do so. Please print and then bring that card to the welcome desk in the back in the lobby, and we will have a gift for you there as well. It's time for us to continue to worship the Lord with our tithes and our offerings. This is an opportunity we have to give back to God. God has given to us. He's asked us to be good stewards of what he has given to us. And part of that stewardship is to give through our tithes and our offerings. I thank you for your continued generosity. Just a reminder, in the year before the pandemic started, we raised $10,000 for a new carpet. And then the pandemic came, and so we waited and waited, and finally, thank the Lord, we have this beautiful new carpet that's in. I thank Greg Berrios, not here today, but he'd be upset if I mentioned his name if he was here, but since he's not here, I'm going to mention his name. Greg did a great job in helping with all of this. The ladies who came and helped out yesterday to put up a lot of the Christmas decorations, I think they could probably use some extra help at the end of service as well. But thank you all so much for your generosity of your time. And now this is the time that you are able to give the generosity of your pockets, your wallets, your pocketbooks. Let's pray for our offering as our ushers come forward. Father, thank you, God, for what you've given to us. Thank you, God, for even these physical signs of your grace to us, and how you are building your church thanks to the generosity of your people, the obedience of your people. Lord, let us continue to honor you through our giving and through the rest of our service. In Jesus' name, amen. You're welcome to come down to give your offering. Also, there's a green card in front of you on your pew that you can point your smartphone on and give through the internet as well.
Oh, praise to him who reigns above in majesty supreme, who gave his son for man to die, that he might man redeem. Oh, blessed be the name, blessed be the name, blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name, blessed be the name, blessed be the name of the Lord.
His name above all names shall stand, exalted more and more, at God the Father's own right hand, where angel hosts adore.
Blessed be the name, blessed be the name, blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name, blessed be the name, blessed be the name of the Lord.
Redeemer, Savior, friend of man, once ruined by the fall, thou hast devised salvation's plan, for thou hast died for all.
Oh, blessed be the name, blessed be the name,
Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name, blessed be the name. Blessed be the name of the Lord.
His name shall be the Counselor, the Mighty Prince of Peace, of all earth's kingdoms conqueror, whose name shall never cease.
Oh, blessed be the name, blessed be the name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name, blessed be the name. Blessed be the name of the Lord.
Oh, blessed be the name,
blessed be the name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name,
blessed be the name.
Blessed be the name of the Lord.
Morning. We have some announcements here for today, but before I do the say the announcements, that worship when we all came together and said, "Holy is the name of the Lord," that really touched me. I don't know if it touched any of you guys, but that's so powerful. So powerful. The Holy Spirit is definitely moving. All right. Announcements. Wednesday night Bible study meets at 7 p.m. in the White Fellowship Hall. Come join us as we explore and apply God's word together. Amen. Christmas falls on a Sunday this year. Riverside will have two services available. One on Christmas Eve, Saturday, December 24th at 7, and one on Christmas Day, Sunday, December 25th at 10:30. Each one-hour service will have the same content. So if you can't make Sunday service, Saturday service available. If you can't make Saturday service, Sunday service available. The men's ministry breakfast will take place on Saturday, December 17th. At Vic's Waffle House in Tewksbury at 9 a.m. I encourage all the men brothers to come out and join us for pre-Christmas Eve breakfast. Also on December 17th, we have the, Nada, if I'm correct, the women's breakfast on December 17th in the White Fellowship Hall at 11 a.m. At 11 a.m. So the women, you guys can come out and eat on Saturday as well. So everyone will be having a nice breakfast on Saturday, December 17th. Riverside Prayer Team stands ready to pray for you. Email prayer at riversideag.com or text 2978-873-PRAY. And now we will dismiss our children. We'll pray and dismiss our children for Children's Church. Let us pray. Father God, we thank you, Father. We thank you for the children that you've blessed us with. We thank you for the teachers, the instructors, the helpers, everyone involved in We Worship and Children's Church. Lord, I pray, Lord, that you fill their hearts, Lord, with your love, your peace, your grace, your mercy. Lord, fill them and teach them, Lord, your word. Lord, teach them what you want them to know, Lord, what you want them to hear. And Lord, we give you the glory in Jesus' name. Amen. Children, you are dismissed.
We'll see you later, kids. Have a great time in Children's Church. Your opportunity to hear what Jesus has to say. Well, good morning, everybody. It's good to see you all, and here it is December. Could you imagine if our heat still wasn't working now? It'd be quite chilly, but thank the Lord, He continues to provide, and by His grace through His leading your heart into generosity, we continue to be able to not just maintain, but to move forward in the kingdom. In the 1950s, television started to become a mainstay in American homes. Families would gather around the TV, watch TV together. And television networks found out that putting sports on TV could raise a lot of advertising dollars. And so they would put sports and baseball and football on TV. And one of the sports that they put on was the relatively slow-moving sport of golf. Now, I don't enjoy watching golf all that much, but in those days, the early days of TV, even golf could be exciting to watch on TV. And golf on TV, it really turned out to be quite popular. And it gave birth to golf's first real superstar. His name was Arnold Palmer. Arnold Palmer began winning tournaments on television way back, starting in 1955. He was one of the winningest players in the history of the sport. He was one of the big three of the time, in addition to Jack Nicklaus and Gary Player, who are credited with popularizing and commercializing the sport of golf. Before that, it was just something that exclusive country clubs, but now suddenly it had become a sport that people could play. Plus, Arnold Palmer invented the delicious combination of iced tea and lemonade called the Arnold Palmer. And if you go to a good restaurant, as long as it iced tea doesn't come from a fountain. As long as they really brew their iced tea and they make their lemonade and you mix those two together, oh, that's my favorite thing to order to drink at a restaurant. But some don't know, and you say, can I have an Arnold Palmer? And they say, what's that? It's like half iced tea, half lemonade. Arnold Palmer invented that. If for nothing else, he's a superstar in my book because of this. Well, Arnold Palmer used to tell a story of his participation in the 1961 Masters Tournament. It was the final hole of the tournament, and Arnold Palmer had a one-stroke lead over the rest of the field. He approached the tee for the 18th hole, and he hit a beautiful tee shot, high and long and straight. And as he walked along the fairway towards his ball, he waved at the crowd that lined the course, who was there to watch the tournament. And as he approached the ball, he noticed an old friend that was standing at the edge of the gallery of people. And the friend motioned him over, and so Arnold Palmer walked over, and they shook hands, and the man was saying, congratulations, congratulations. And as soon as Arnold Palmer shook his friend's hand, he realized that he had lost his focus. He had been honed in on that last hole, and seeing his friend and shaking hands, he'd lost his focus. In his next two shots, he hit the ball into a sand trap. Then he hit it over the edge of the green. Then he missed a putt, and he ended up finishing tied for second place, one stroke down. Arnold Palmer said, you don't forget a mistake like that. You learn from it. You determine that you'll never do it again. And Arnold Palmer said, I haven't lost my focus during a game in the 30 years since, in the 40 years since. Listen, if we're going to live as conquerors in the life, not just maintaining things, but conquering and moving forward, we need to keep our focus on Jesus. We're studying the book of Revelation. This is the story of Earth's final chapter. Last week, we finished chapter 18. And we saw the different reactions at the destruction of the symbolic city of Babylon. Those who indulged and profited from the sinful pleasures of Babylon, well, they were mourning her destruction. But the righteous rejoiced at God's justice. And today we begin chapter 19 of the book of Revelation. If you want to begin and start turning towards book chapter 19 of Revelation, that's where we're going to be today. And in chapter 19, we'll see how praise in the heavenly realms is directed to God. We'll see the announcement of the wedding supper of the Lamb, and we'll see the importance of keeping our focus on Jesus. Let's pray together. Father, this is your word. And as I share your word and what you shared with me, God, I pray that all of our hearts, including mine, will be open for what your Spirit has to say to us. Help us, Lord, to focus on you, not on anything else, just you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I want you to imagine for a moment a group of believers in Asia Minor in the first century. Say in the church in the city of Smyrna, bustling town, huge port city. And there were a group of believers there who formed a church, but they are under constant pressure to recant their faith in Christ. Pressure from the government, pressure from their neighbors, pressure from the Jewish priests in the area. They're a small group of believers, and they're meeting in people's houses. Perhaps they're even moving from house to house to avoid a raid from the Roman authorities, or maybe even avoiding an angry mob of people who are riled up by the Pharisees. Maybe their families have been threatened. They're surely have been ostracized by the community. They've lost jobs. They've lost business. They've been harassed. They've been beaten. But this small group of believers meeting home to home is still persevering. They're persevering through the tribulation. They're persevering through the trials. They know that their faith is not based on their circumstances, but rather their faith is based on the work of Jesus Christ on the cross. And then this group of believers, hiding out in someone's home, moving in the shadows to get to church, this group of believers hears that the Apostle John has had a vision from God. And not only that, this vision that John has, it was addressed to them. It's from Jesus, and it's addressed to them in Smyrna. They're going to get a letter from Jesus. God has given through Jesus and then through John a letter for them. Jesus knows their address. No matter whose house they're going to meet at, the letter's going to be for them. He knows their situation. Plus, the letter's going to tell them about what's going to happen in the future. And when the letter comes, it tells them that Jesus does indeed know their situation. He knows their address. He knows their situation. And he commends them for their perseverance. He says, good job. You've done so well in persevering through all the tribulations that surround you. Well done. This is a letter from Jesus telling them, good job. Well done. And now for the future. The letter says, some of you are going to prison. Some of you will even be killed for your faith. The letter says that that pattern of persecution is going to continue throughout the history of the church. It's always going to be there as the church is here on earth. Now, there may have been those among the church in Smyrna, among the Christians huddled together there in someone's living room who saw this as a good news, bad news kind of thing. All right, God's proud of us, but persecution isn't ending anytime soon. But hopefully they didn't get up and leave after chapter 3, because the vision continues. In the vision, they see the glory of God the Father. They see the perfect Spirit of God, and they see the Lamb of God, Jesus, as if slain from the foundation of the world. And the vision is cast far into the future, into the final chapter of human history. And the persecution does continue until the final chapter for the followers of Jesus Christ. But the tide begins to turn. You see, punishment and judgment is poured out upon the wicked. That's what the letter says. The redeemed are delivered, and they are protected, and the time of persecution is over. And it will, this time, it will be over for all of eternity. Imagine the relief of getting a letter like that. These poor, bedraggled Christians. Here's the letter from Jesus, and he says, it's not always going to be like this. Jesus and his followers are going to emerge victorious. But don't let me get too far ahead of myself. When we left off in chapter 18, the city of Babylon is described as the great prostitute, and it's been destroyed. City of Babylon is a symbol in John's vision. Babylon represents the lust, the greed, the pride and prejudice which tempts mankind to run from God, which tempts mankind to stray from God's will. It's the priorities of the world personified in the city of Babylon and personified by the beast, a world leader doing the bidding of Satan. But now the kingdom of the beast has fallen. Those who tasted the pleasures of Babylon mourn its passing. Those who made profit off its vices, they mourn their loss of income. The wicked mourn the passing at the center of their sinfulness. But in the heavenly throne room, well, things are a lot different. In contrast to the mourning voices, John the Revelator notes the following. Revelation 19, verses 1 through 3. After this, I heard what sounded like the roar of a great multitude in heaven shouting, Hallelujah! Salvation and glory and power belong to our God. For true and just are his judgments. He has condemned the great prostitute who corrupted the earth by her adulteries. He has avenged on her the blood of his servants. And again they shouted, Hallelujah! The smoke from her goes up forever and ever. John hears the roar of a great multitude. This seems to be the entire host of heaven rejoicing. The angelic beings, the saints of God throughout history, all who have been redeemed, including us. We are part of this great host of heaven, and we sing, Hallelujah! Evil has been destroyed, and God's judgments are just. They shout, Hallelujah! Now that word means praise to the Lord. They are shouting, God, you be praised. That praise is given direction. It's saying, God, all this praise is to you. Our joy is a result of what you have done. All the glory goes to you, God, because this judgment is real. This judgment is just. The great prostitute of Babylon has been condemned. The time of temptation is over. The time of persecution, it's over, now and forever. No wonder everyone's excited. I mean, we go through some stuff, don't we? But imagine receiving, being at that time and saying, all that stuff you've ever gone through, it's done on earth. All the difficulties, all the trials, all the tribulations, it's done. And then the lens of John's vision zooms in on the 24 elders and those strange angelic creatures around the throne. They have places of honor, and they are important, but look at what they do. Verse 4 of chapter 19. The 24 elders and the four living creatures fell down and worshiped God, who was seated on the throne. And they cried, Amen! Hallelujah! Now, we've seen this before. These elders always seem to be a little uncomfortable on their thrones. Because every time we've seen them, they're always getting off and bowing down to the one on the throne. There's no doubt about who the center of attention is here. The elders, the angels, they may have had places of distinction, but it is God and God alone who deserves the praise. Amen is a declaration of agreement. Some of you just said amen. That word amen means I agree. That word amen means let it be done. That word amen says yes. And that is what the 24 elders and the angelic beings are saying after they've heard this praise from the host of heaven. Hallelujah! God's reign is forever. His justice is complete. After they've heard that, they all say, let it be so.
I agree. I echo that word, hallelujah. Another voice encourages the celebration in verse 5. Then a voice came from the throne saying, praise our God, all you his servants, you who fear him, both great and small. Now this is probably an angelic being, maybe one of the four who sits before the throne of God. And he's saying, keep it coming, guys. Keep it up. Keep this praise going, all of you, no matter what you were on the earth. Whether you were great or small, whether you're one of the 24 elders or whether you're someone who got saved right before the end, that doesn't matter. All of you, no matter what you consider your position to be, he's worthy of praise. Your position doesn't make a difference on his worthiness of our praise. And as John watches the rejoicing in heaven, it must be overwhelming. Because look at what verse 6 says. Then I heard what sounded like a great multitude, like the roar of rushing waters and like loud peals of thunder, shouting, hallelujah, for the Lord God Almighty reigns. Praise the Lord, it's saying again. God reigns. He is the victorious king. We're celebrating him. We're celebrating his reign, his authority. Everybody's very happy. Because not only has God conquered sin, temptation, and persecution, but there's another special thing. There's going to be a wedding. Verse 7. Let us rejoice and be glad and give him glory, for the wedding of the Lamb has come, and his bride has made herself ready. The time has finally come, the wedding of the church, the bride of Christ, to the Lamb of God, united forever. No more persecution, no more temptation, no more sinful Babylon. And the bride of Christ, it says, has made herself ready. Now, how has the bride of Christ made herself ready? Look at verse 8. Fine linen, bright and clean, was given for her to wear. Fine linen stands for the righteous acts of God's holy people. Righteous acts of God's people, but not righteous acts under our own power. Because it says the linen, the righteous acts, were given to her. It is Christ who provided the way for the bride to be ready. This is so amazing. John seems to almost forget that there's an angel standing next to him, and he's got a job to do. He's supposed to be writing this down. Look at verse 9. Then the angel said to me, write this, blessed are those who are invited to the wedding supper of the Lamb. And then he added, these are the true words of God. The angel says, okay, make sure you're recording this, John. Let the people who are going to receive this letter, let them know how happy these people are to be included in the wedding. Because the people who are receiving this letter, they're invited to the wedding too. You can trust these words, John. They're coming from God himself. And then poor John gets a little confused in verse 10. At this, I fell at his feet to worship him. But he said to me, don't do that. I'm a fellow servant with you and with your brothers and sisters who hold to the testimony of Jesus. Worship God, for it is the spirit of prophecy who bears testimony to Jesus. The angel's saying, keep your focus, John. I know your eyes are distracted because my clothes are bright and shiny, but I'm just a fellow servant like you. I'm just a fellow servant like your fellow apostles. I'm just a fellow servant like the brothers and sisters that you are writing this letter to in the churches in Asia Minor. I'm a fellow servant like the brothers and sisters who 2,000 years from now will be sitting at Riverside Assembly of God in Methuen, Massachusetts. I am a fellow servant along with them. Keep your focus, John. This needs to be said to them. When we continue the chapter next week, the final battle with the enemy's remaining forces will begin. But what lessons can we take today from what we've heard? How can we take this passage of the rejoicing of the multitude of heaven praising God? How can we take this and apply it to our lives? Let me share with you the lessons I'm taking away. First is this. Praise is directed to him who sits on the throne. So as a result of the destruction of Babylon, John records that all of heaven begins to rejoice. There's understandable joy here. The reign of sin is over. Persecution, temptation, these are no more. The followers of God are elated at the fall of their symbolic enemy. But they're not just saying, whoopee! It's not like V-Day in Times Square. You've seen the pictures of the declaration of the end of World War II at the end of World War II, and people just jumping up and down and screaming and running out into the street in Times Square, and they're saying, woo, woo. This praise is different. This rejoicing is different because it's directed at one person. It's directed at God. This rejoicing says, praise be to the Lord. Salvation, glory, honor, these things belong to God, the one who's sitting on the throne. Even the elders on their many thrones, once again, can't stay seated. They fall down on the ground. Their praise is directed to the one who sits on the throne. Everybody is happy that evil has been conquered, but they realize they didn't really do anything. They're happy that evil is conquered and that they've been saved, but that salvation comes from God, who sits on the throne. So they're rejoicing his voice in the form of praise to the one who brought them their salvation. The enemy has been conquered. All praise be to the conqueror. Evil has faced its judgment. All worship is given to the judge. When good things happen to us, we get happy. We rejoice at good things in our lives. But let's not forget where those good things came from. It's great to be happy when something good happens, but remember where that good thing came from. James 1, 16 through 17 said, don't be deceived, my dear brothers and sisters. Every good and perfect gift is from above, coming down from the Father of the heavenly lights, who does not change like shifting shadows. When good things happen, let your rejoicing be voiced through praise to the one who sits on the throne and unto the Lamb. You might say, well, I did this myself. I got this good thing through me. I got this raise at my job. I got a promotion at my job through working hard. Well, who gave you the ability to work hard? Who gave you the job? Who gave you the breath of life so that you could work hard? Every good thing comes from God, and he deserves all the praise. Here's the second lesson. Our righteous acts come from God. This heavenly praise fest turns into a wedding celebration. Throughout the Gospels and throughout the epistles, the church has been referred to as the bride of Christ. And now at last, in the final chapter, the wedding supper takes place. We, the followers of God, we are his bride, to be joined together with him in perfect unity. And we, the bride, are dressed appropriately. The Bible says we're dressed in fine linen, bright and clean. And then in this surprising moment of explanation, which doesn't happen too often in Revelation, the symbol is explained. We're told what these clothes represent. The fine linens are the righteous acts of God's people. Acts of love, acts of grace, acts of forgiveness, acts of kindness, acts of perseverance. These acts of righteousness are what clothes us for the wedding supper of the Lamb. But where do these fine linens come from? Where do these righteous acts come from? Revelation says we are given them by God. It's He who empowers us to do these acts of righteousness. It is Jesus who gave us the example of love and grace and forgiveness and kindness and perseverance. Jesus showed us that we wouldn't know righteousness, let alone be able to do it, if it was not for God's word in our lives. He gives us the ability to do acts of righteousness. Our ability to do these things comes from God. But don't be confused. It's not the righteous acts that got these people into heaven. Okay, they're already in heaven. They haven't earned their way into heaven. These acts are only counted as righteousness because they are already part of the kingdom of God. And our becoming part of the kingdom of God is also given to us. It's given to us through the Lamb of God. Remember the description of Jesus, the Lamb, from Revelation chapter 5? John says that he saw the Lamb looking as if he had been slain. It is through the death of the Lamb and the resurrection of Jesus that we are able to become part of the kingdom and be clothed in linen bright and clean. On the cross, Jesus' body was destroyed. The same destruction that laid waste to Babylon. He took the punishment for your sins. He took the punishment for my sin, so that we would not be destroyed along with Babylon. He shed his blood to wash those linens clean. And he rose again to give us new life. We're going to be sharing communion in just a couple minutes to remember that gift. But first, let me give you the third lesson I'm taking away, and that's keep your focus on Jesus. Even though John had this amazing experience, he still got confused. He drops to his knees and starts trying to worship the angel. But the angel's not having any of that. He says, knock it off, John. I'm just a servant like you. And the angel directs the worship back to him who sits on the throne. The angel was bright and shiny. You can understand a little bit. The angel was bright and shiny because he was reflecting the glory of God. So we might understand a little bit of John's initial confusion. But the angel spoke truth, and he redirected the glory to Jesus. So here's the lesson. Don't be distracted by the glitter. Don't be distracted by the shininess. Keep your focus on Jesus. There are men and women of great prophetic voices who preach the gospel of Jesus Christ. And they may reflect God's goodness, God's power, God's love. But keep your focus on Jesus, not on his servants. Heaven forbid that I ever receive any glory that is supposed to go to Jesus. In fact, if somebody speaking prophetically doesn't direct your focus to Jesus, pay no attention to them at all. Because if they speak the truth, then they're going to redirect your heart to Jesus. And should you receive any praise, should you receive any adulation, let it go to Calvary. Direct it back to Jesus. Point people to what Jesus has done on the cross. May God's glory be our focus. As we pause to remember the cross, let's turn our eyes upon Jesus. I'm going to ask Don and Caden to come back up. In a little bit, they're going to lead in a song as we distribute the communion. Let me just tell you a little something about our communion. First of all, we have an open communion, meaning anybody here can take communion. You don't have to be a member of the church. You don't have to have been coming to the church for a certain amount of time. You're welcome to take communion with us. But you should only do it if you've given your life to Jesus. If you haven't given your life to Jesus yet, if you have not become his disciple, don't look at this as some ceremony that means nothing, because it means something. The bread that is broken is representative of the body of Jesus. The blood is represented by the cup. These are serious things. And the Bible talks about some serious consequences if you take communion unworthily. But here's the thing. There's nothing you can do in yourself to make yourself worthy. Only Jesus' blood can do that. If you've never given your life to Jesus, you can do that right now. As we pray and as we distribute these elements of communion, I encourage you, speak to God. Just like he's right next to you, because you know what? He is. He's knocking at the door of your heart and saying, I want to come in. If you will say, Jesus, I know I'm a sinner. And I'm going to turn my way around by following you. I believe in you. Then the Bible says that Jesus will take away every sin that you've ever done. Separate himself from your sin so he sees them no more. I'm going to ask the ushers to come forward. And as we pass out the elements, I want to encourage you to just spend some time in the presence of God. You can sing along with Don, but just take some time to listen to what God is saying to your heart as we remember.
I cast my mind to Calvary, where Jesus bled and died for me. I see his wounds, his hands, his feet. My Savior on that cursed tree. His body bound and drenched in tears, they lay him down in Joseph's tomb, the entrance sealed by heavy stone. Messiah still and all alone. Oh, praise the name of the Lord.
Of the Lord our
Has everyone been served? We want to make sure we didn't leave anybody out. Anybody that was not served, just raise your hand. We'll get some to you. 1 Corinthians 11. Paul is writing to his friends at the Corinthian church, and they haven't been doing communion right at all. He starts in his instructions saying, I don't have any praise for you when it comes to doing the Lord's Supper. You're not doing it correctly. You're thinking of it as a snack, and that's not what it is. And he says this starting in verse 23, for I received from the Lord what I also passed on to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took the bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, this is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me. Heavenly Father, your body was beaten, pierced, broken. You suffered humiliation and what looked to the outside world like defeat. But by that destruction, we were able to have life. We thank you today, and we remember your broken body. In the name of Jesus, we pray.
Amen.
Amen. Let's partake of the bread together. Paul continued his letter and said, in the same way, after supper, Jesus took the cup, saying, this cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. And then Paul adds, for whenever you eat this bread and you drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. That's what we're doing, brothers and sisters. We're proclaiming that Jesus died, and we're remembering its purpose to redeem us, to buy us back so we could be part of the family of God and the bride of Christ. Heavenly Father, I thank you for your the shed blood of your Son, which wipes away every sin, which cleans me, so that I can be presented pure and holy at the wedding supper of the Lamb. And even now, even today, you look at me as holy because of the shed blood of Jesus. And in the name of Jesus we pray. Amen. Let's partake of the cup together. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. At this time, we're going to open up the altars. If you are sick in body, if you need somebody to pray for you, our prayer team, I'm going to ask them to come up and be here and be ready to pray with those who are sick. If you've got just some need that you want somebody to pray with you, this is an opportunity to have somebody stand with you in prayer. If you just want to spend time at the altar and give him praise, you're welcome to do that as well. But don't rush out. Be willing to linger in his presence. Because his presence is here.
Amen.
So as we sing, you're welcome to sing along just as a time of praise. In fact, we encourage it. But allow the Spirit of Jesus to touch your heart as we have partaken the body and the blood. Let his presence around us and within us encourage us. Don't leave without God finishing the work that he started in you today.